I love libertarians so much. If there's one thing I would like people to know about me, it's my deep personal love for all libertarians. Okay, but seriously, I have, I believe, been unnecessarily provocative when it comes to certain groups that I disagree with. Libertarians are one of these groups, but other groups too, such as non-Catholic Christians. I'm not saying that I want to disagree with and criticize these groups, but some of the stuff I've done, both on my channel and on Twitter and other places, I think has been unproductive, and I really don't want to start unnecessary fights. I think it's still very important to point out the ways that I think libertarianism has negatively affected the right. But I'd like to do this without being unnecessarily provocative. So I didn't really want to make this video today, but there are some things that I really just get the feeling I have to make a video about, because the error in question is too big to leave unrefuted. And that issue today is libertarianism and Christianity, particularly the way in which at least some parts of libertarianism is incompatible with Christianity. Okay, but why am I talking about this? Well, yesterday on Twitter, I was being, I suppose you could say, unnecessarily provocative. I sent out a brief joke tweet, you know, nothing too serious. The tweet said, "All sin should be illegal." Now, this is obviously a joke. It's obviously incredibly impractical to ban every single sin. I'm sure you can imagine just how many sins there are in Catholicism, and how it would simply be impossible to police many different sins. There's actually quite a bit of Catholic theology on this specific point, on the prohibition of vices, and whether or not it is mandatory for civil authorities to prohibit vices. And the answer is no, it's not mandatory for all governments at all times to prohibit all vices. Now, that doesn't mean that governments can just allow all vices to go wild, and that they can just ignore vices, but the simple fact that something is a sin does not mean that it has to be banned. If prohibiting something would cause more harm in the attempt to prohibit it than would be caused by simply leaving the matter alone, at least on the level of the government, then there's no need whatsoever for the authority to try to prohibit that vice. This mirrors quite closely how God has established the universe, because the existence of anything means that it is a part of God's will, whether that is God's active will or God's permissive will. Any bad in the universe is permitted to exist by God to bring out greater goods. God cannot command evil, but he can permit it to continue to occur, just as he permits all evil that happens. The classic example of this is, of course, free will. For God to allow us to have free will, he needs to also allow us to sin and to reject him. So, just as God, in the ordering of the universe, can allow people to sin to allow for the existence of the good of free will, so can civil authorities allow some sins to occur, to prevent the negative effects that trying to prohibit those sins could have. Okay, so you probably think it's unnecessary that I just spent like 2 minutes debunking a joke tweet that I sent out. But I do think it's necessary for this discussion. Why is that necessary? Well, because in reply to this tweet, I had one of my followers, who is an anarcho-capitalist, say, "Stealing and extortion are sins, therefore the state cannot exist to enforce this. It is the church and community's responsibility to correct sinners." So, for anyone unfamiliar with anarcho-capitalism, it is heavily based on the idea that taxation is theft, or at the very least, extortion. Extortion and theft are immoral, therefore the existence of the state is immoral. Perhaps one day I will do a more secular refutation of anarcho-capitalism. However, that is not how Scrams Hoppe challenged me on this topic. He did not say that taxation and the state is immoral. He said that it's a sin. He challenged me on specifically religious grounds, so I will give him a specifically religious answer. And if you look at his bio, he has Orthodox Inquirer there. So I'm going to assume that he really believes in Christianity, and he really believes in the Orthodox Church. The problem with the anarcho-capitalist line, the idea that the state is inherently illegitimate, is that it simply does not exist anywhere in the Christian tradition. It certainly does not exist anywhere in apostolic Christianity, whether that's Eastern Orthodoxy or Roman Catholicism. If you examine the minds of the Church Fathers, of the ecumenical councils, of the saints and of the doctors of either of those churches, you're simply not going to find anarcho-capitalism anywhere. What you are actually going to find is that in both of those churches, it has always been taught that the authority of governments comes directly from God, far from governments in themselves being illegitimate. Even in Protestantism, this idea is simply nowhere in the tradition. Martin Luther, John Calvin, Zwingli, I mean, any of them, really? They all obviously were not anarcho-capitalists. Just as one example, John Calvin famously reshaped Geneva along Calvinist lines, with famously strict prohibitions of many different vices. But the one saving grace that an anarcho-capitalist Protestant would have is at least you can always invent your own Protestant tradition. If Zwingli was able to say 500 years ago that he can only conclude that from the time of the apostles until when he was writing, all of the doctors of the church have always been in error on the matter of baptismal regeneration, then it's not much more ridiculous to say that for the past 2,000 years, every great theologian, Protestant, Catholic, or Orthodox, has been wrong about the authority of the state. But, as we've already determined, Scram's Hoppe is Orthodox. So, let's look at this from the lens of apostolic Christianity. As I've already said, the moral illegitimacy of the state is simply nowhere in the tradition of either the Catholic or Orthodox Church. To understand this, first we need to go back directly to the Bible. The two most famous passages in the New Testament on the authority of the state is Render Unto Caesar and Romans 13. Render Unto Caesar is found in three of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And the message of the passage is quite clear. You have a duty to pay taxes, even if Caesar is a bad guy. Now, I'm sure you could play libertarian word games and say that actually the secret meaning of this passage, the real meaning that everyone's been wrong about for all these years, is that everything belongs to God, therefore you don't have to give anything to Caesar. Or, alternatively, you could also redefine this passage to just be saying that it's not worth getting in a fight with Caesar to not pay your taxes, even though what Caesar is doing is immoral. But what have the church fathers and the saints said on this passage? Did they interpret it on libertarian lines? Well, let's look at a few examples. Justin Martyr said, "Whence to God alone we render worship, but in other things we gladly serve you, acknowledging you as kings and rulers of men, and praying that with your kingly power you be found to possess also sound judgment." This interpretation from St. Justin Martyr is more radical than what the text even just implies. He doesn't just say that you should pay your taxes, but he also turns this into an exaltation of civil governors. St. John Chrysostom on this passage said, "For it is possible both to fulfill to men their claims and to give unto God the things that are due to God from us." Wherefore, Paul also says, "Render unto all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear." Again here, Chrysostom is clearly saying that you have a duty to pay tribute, that is, taxation. And not only that, he is also, once again, linking render unto Caesar to not only taxation in general, but to submission to civil authorities. As one more example on this passage, I'll cite Theophilit, who, granted, is not a church father, but is a saint in the Eastern Orthodox Church. He said, "Jesus persuades them by means of the image of Caesar engraved on the coin, that one must render to Caesar which is his, namely, that which bears his image, and that in bodily and external things. One must submit to the king, but in inner and spiritual things, one must submit to God." Once again, it couldn't be clearer. Submission is due to Caesar. That which bears the image of Caesar is due to him, both literally, as in the coin, and metaphorically. I think that should show pretty clearly how render unto Caesar has been interpreted historically within apostolic Christianity. In particular, both Justin Martyr and Chrysostom are some of the most respected saints and church fathers within both the Catholic and Orthodox Church. And there is, as I've already said, one other highly relevant part of the Bible, Romans 13. To be particular, actually, it is Romans 13, verses 1 through 7. That section goes, "Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, For there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval. For he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjugation, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For because of this, you also pay taxes. For the authorities are ministers of God, attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them. Taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. Romans 13 is not a particularly ambiguous passage. I don't think there's much there that's hard to understand. I think it's quite clear that St. Paul does not view civil authorities as inherently unjust. Much the opposite, he says that you have a duty to obey them. I mean, I don't know how Paul could have made this passage any clearer. He even specifically says, therefore, one must be in subjugation, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. How is that not clear? In more recent Catholic political thought, both Francisco Suarez and Pope Leo XIII clearly taught that not only the state, but also the church, have a right to act as coercive agents. These two figures are some of the Catholic Church's most important political philosophers. And Pope Leo, many of his works are, of course, magisterial teaching. That shows one other thing that Scrams Hoppe was wrong about in his tweet. Not only does the state have the right to coerce, but it is also not the job of the church to simply be some sort of community institution that is, in some sort of voluntary fashion, correcting sinners. The belief that the church has no right to coerce, or that the coercion of the church is limited to things like excluding people from communion, is anathematized in the Council of Trent. The Catholic Church believes she has the right to coerce all baptized Christians. And that is not just baptized Catholics. That is anyone of any denomination that has received a valid baptism. And, of course, including if they were baptized as infants, as most Catholics are. But, okay, all that is obviously just papist nonsense. As I've already said, the person I'm responding to is Eastern Orthodox, so why would he care what the Council of Trent says? As we all know, one of the major issues during the East-West Schism was anarcho-capitalism. It was right up there with the filioque and leaven versus unleavened bread. The papists were all statists, and the Patriarch of Constantinople, Salarius, was famously a libertarian. That is, of course, not the history. The mere existence of many saint emperors in the Eastern Orthodox Church alone should be enough to prove that the moral illegitimacy of the state is totally foreign to Eastern Orthodoxy. Justinian and Constantine are the two most famous saint emperors in the Orthodox Church, but there are also many others. One modern example of a teaching from the Orthodox Church that is very much incompatible with anarcho-capitalism would be from the Russian Orthodox Church's The Basis of the Social Concept. The document is essentially the Orthodox Church's way of explaining how they think society should be organized. And in the third section on church and state, it says, God blesses the state as an essential element of life in the world distorted by sin, in which both the individual and society need to be protected from the dangerous manifestations of sin. God blesses the state. I don't know how much clearer it could get than that. And in that same document, it also says that the Orthodox Church believes she possesses coercive authority, just as the Catholic Church also believes she possesses that same authority. It says, guided by this norm, Emperor Saint Justinian, in his novellas, recognized the church canons as having the power of state laws. To give another example for something that should be persuasive to an Orthodox Christian would be Saint John Chrysostom's homily on Romans 13. Saint John Chrysostom is a church father, and I've already mentioned him earlier in this video. He's highly respected in both the Catholic and Orthodox churches, but in the Orthodox Church especially, he is one of the most celebrated church fathers. In this homily, he says, "Is every ruler then elected by God? This I do not say." He answers, "Nor am I speaking about individual rulers, but about the thing in itself. For that there should be rulers, and some rule and others ruled, that all things should not be carried on in one confusion, the people swaying like waves in this direction and that, this, I say, is the work of God's wisdom." Hence, he does not say, "For there is no ruler but of God," but it is the thing he speaks of, and says, "There is no power but of God." Once again, Chrysostom is making himself very clear here. "For that there should be rulers, and some rule and others ruled, that is of God," he says. The homily is very good, and I'd highly recommend reading the whole thing. The entire thing is clearly just not libertarian. One other thing that he says in this homily is that he who listens not thereto is fighting with God who framed these laws. I could cite more and more fathers and saints if I needed to, but if this is not enough to prove to you that the idea that the state is inherently immoral is incompatible with apostolic Christianity, then I don't think you will be convinced of that. And I would like to give a reminder why this is such an important thing. Both the Catholic and Orthodox Church claim to not just be an institution that is trying to reflect biblical values, but an institution which was actually personally and directly established by Jesus Christ. If either church has always been wrong about this, if either church has always taught that coercion from civil authorities is just, but in reality, that coercion is nothing more than theft and extortion, then these churches have been commanding sin for 2,000 years. If that's the case, then neither of these churches can actually be what they claim they are. So you have to choose. What do you believe more, Christianity or anarcho-capitalism? And that is why I think this is such an important topic. That is why I made this whole video responding to a single tweet. Because it's not even so much about this one dude on Twitter. It's because people need to understand, when the church teaches something, you don't get to decide. If the church has always taught for 2,000 years that state authorities are legitimate, they're legitimate. Or you're not a Christian. Those are the options. Being a Christian isn't always easy. When I first became Catholic, I had many beliefs that were not compatible with my new faith. Giving way on those beliefs is not always easy. But if you're serious about this, if this isn't just a LARP, if this isn't just something you're doing because you think that Christianity is a pro-social force, then obeying the church, obeying the Bible, and rejecting your own beliefs is what you have to do. Thanks everyone for watching. Please like, comment, subscribe, hit the bell, and share these videos with anyone who you think will enjoy them. And a special thanks to my donors, yourself, Siphius Rex, Litta, The Right Cafe, Quo Precranator, Adzutko, Josiah, King of Evil Florida and the Moon, Seth Apex, Richard, Cringewalker, Zian Harris, Thomas Thomist, Windowlick, Augustine, Sky Toucher, Max Jerome, and Matthias the Templar. Thanks everyone again for watching, and goodbye.